When you think of witches, what comes to mind? Maybe her? Maybe these funny ladies? Many believe in the powers of the supernatural, but if we lived years ago, we could be imprisoned for even talking about these kinds of things. It's time we break down the Salem Witch Trials. It's February 1692, and we're in the village of Salem, Massachusetts. The Puritans settled in Salem in 1626, and these were hard times for people. There was constant fighting between French settlers and Native Americans, and that left this community really isolated, and life was extremely strict for them. Relationships in the village were strained between neighbors, and they feared disease and starvation. Just think, no modern heating or electric, very little medicine, and food is very scarce. The Puritan religion was really one of the most important things to uphold at this time, and there was a lot of paranoia about the supernatural at this time. Culture and Puritan beliefs at that time were that women were inherently more sinful and more susceptible to damnation than men were. Women were deemed to be much more susceptible to seduction by the devil. They also said that women were weak-willed and had loose tongues. So it's the winter of 1692, and it was actually one of the coldest, most frigid winters on record, so the village was very on edge. One fateful day that winter, two cousins, 9-year-old Betty Paris and 11-year-old Abigail Williams, started exhibiting strange behavior. They were having fits and contorting their bodies. This spread, and 12 more girls started this bizarre, scary behavior too. They complained that their skin felt prickly and that spirits were touching them. The families had a doctor come examine the girls, and the doctor said that there was nothing physically wrong with them, but that they were under the hand of evil. This struck a huge chord with the Puritans, as it was a part of their belief that the devil would bring evil to the world through human agents, also known as witches. All heck broke loose, and four of those little girls actually accused three grown women of tormenting them. Little did they know that these accusations would go on to be life sentences for these women.
Crazy facts about the Salem witch trials. Giles Corey, an elderly man accused of witchcraft, was pressed to death with heavy stones because he refused to enter a plea during his trial. His last words were, "More weight." The famous witch's mark used as evidence during the trials was often a simple bodily blemish, like a mole or birthmark, which was believed to be a sign of the devil's mark. At one point during the trials, a dunking test was used to determine guilt or innocence. The accused person's hands and feet were bound, and they were thrown into a body of water. If they floated, were guilty. If they sank, they were innocent. Betty Paris and Abigail Williams, the afflicted girls who accused others of witchcraft, later admitted to making false accusations and apologized for their actions. Ever heard of the witch trials outside Salem? Though Salem is often spotlighted, it's crucial to note that witch hunts were not an exclusively American ordeal. They were indeed a horrifying global spectacle. Take, for instance, Germany in the 1600s, where the Würzburg witch trials took place. This trial resulted in the execution of an estimated 600 people accused of witchcraft, a grim figure exceeding Salem's death toll. The frenzy reached such heights that even children as young as 7 weren't spared from accusations. Travel farther to Torsåker, Sweden, in 1675, the location of the most extensive witch trial in Swedish history. The Torsåker witch trials led to a chilling 71 individuals, predominantly women, being beheaded and subsequently burned in a single day. This mass execution was sparked by baseless accusations, where even a stern look or an ill-timed sneeze could land you in deadly trouble. So while Salem may dominate the conversation, it's clear that witch trials were a horrifying and widespread part of
it was 1692, and something strange was happening in the town of Salem. People were accusing their neighbors of being witches. But what exactly were the Salem witch trials, and why did they happen? The Salem witch trials were a series of hearings and prosecutions of people accused of witchcraft. It all started when a group of young girls claimed they were being tormented by witches. Soon, others in the town began to accuse their neighbors of practicing witchcraft. People were accused based on rumors, hearsay, and even dreams. The trials were crazy. People were arrested, thrown in jail, and even killed. It was a time of fear and paranoia, and anyone could be accused, no matter their social status or reputation. In the end, over 200 people were accused of witchcraft, and 20 were executed. It was a dark and tragic time in American history.
Thank you. about the Salem Witch Trials. It may not seem like it, given how much the Salem Witch Trials feature in pop culture and entertainment, but only 26 people were killed during the trials, compared to thousands in Europe's so-called Great Age of Witch Hunts. 9-year-old Elizabeth and 11-year-old Abigail were the first to be diagnosed with bewitchment. When questioned, the girls accused three other women, including Tituba, an enslaved indigenous Caribbean woman. She was likely beaten into submission, but she ultimately confessed to the crime. Giles Corey, a 71-year-old man, refused to enter either an innocent or guilty plea to the court, and his punishment was pretty severe. Heavy stones were pressed against him until he perished. Contrary to popular belief, the accused in Salem were either hanged, tortured, or died in prison. Maybe our cultural fascination with the trials actually comes from our fear.
What if I told you that in 1692, an entire village in Massachusetts was consumed by fear, leading to one of history's most infamous witch hunts? Welcome to Salem, where over 200 people were accused of witchcraft and 20 were executed. But what sparked this hysteria? It all started with a group of girls experiencing mysterious fits, pointing fingers at neighbors, servants, and even family members. The trials were a spectacle, fueled by fear and superstition. Evidence? Spectral evidence, or the testimony of afflicted spirits. By the fall of 1692, 20 innocent lives were taken, victims of fear and a justice system gone awry. The Salem witch trials ended, but the scars remained, reminding us of the dangers of hysteria and injustice. Let's remember Salem not for the witches, but for the lessons it teaches us about fear, justice, and the human spirit. Dive deeper into history, and let's learn from our past. Thanks for joining this journey back in time. Follow for more glimpses into history's most captivating mysteries.
You accuse this woman of being a witch. What evidence do you have?
Big pointy hat, broomstick, what more do you need?
It does seem pretty cut and dry.
I just really feel like we should have some kind of test.
A witch test?
Yeah, something foolproof that tells us if she's dabbled in the dark arts or not.
Can we do like a questionnaire? Multiple choice. Are you a witch? Aren't you a witch?
What if she lies?
Oh, how about this then? We throw her in the river, and if she floats, she's a witch, we burn her. And if she sinks to the bottom and drowns, she's innocent.
Oh yeah, that makes perfect sense. Right, let's give that a go.
Sorry, you don't mind if I just quickly butt in, do you?
No, go ahead.
It's just both those things don't really have a great outcome for me, do they?
Good point. Well, do you have any better ideas?
No, not really.
Right then, throw her in the river, please.
Okay, well, you forced me to do this. I've just had my hair done and I'm not getting it wet.
You know what? I think she was a witch.
Shrine to witches? So did you know there was a bit of a witch problem in the 17th century? Yep, thousands of women's chosen profession was calling upon spirits to put spells on people and do the devil's work. Well, no. These witches actually started as natural healers whose profession became misunderstood as more and more women jumped on the bandwagon. Witchcraft became tainted as evil and was criminalised in the 1500s. 30 years then passed before this guy, King James, cranked it up a bit. He thought all witches were secret agents of the devil and started a literal witch hunt to kill them off. As a result, in the 17th and 18th centuries, more than 3,000 alleged witches were tried in England and Scotland. And this, the Witch's Well in Edinburgh, is a monument to all the accused witches burnt at the stake on the execution ground now covered by Edinburgh Castle Esplanade. The wicked head and serene head signify that some used their exceptional knowledge for evil purposes, while others were misunderstood and wished their kind nothing but good. Do you think witches are real?
These group of women were so deadly and so powerful that even the Nazis feared them and started calling them the Night Witches and were afraid to go to bed because of their raids. In fact, the Nazis hated them so much that if a German airman brought down just one Night Witch, he was automatically rewarded the Iron Cross Medal. So the Night Witches were an all-female 588th Night Bomber Regiment in the Soviet Army during World War II. They were headed by this badass, Marina Raskova, who was the Soviet's version of Amelia Earhart. The irony is the 588th Regiment was supposed to have the least qualified female pilots, but they turned out to be the deadliest. And that's because these women turned their disadvantages into their strengths. So the planes that these women flew were hand-me-down relics, and they would just call them coffin with wings because they were made with plywood and canvas, and if a bullet hit it, they could possibly burst into flames. The plane's top speed was only 90 miles per hour and could only carry 2 bombs, so the women couldn't even carry parachutes because it would weigh down the plane. They also had to fly down very low, which means that the enemy could spot them, which is why they went out on their raids at night. So when these badass women came close to their targets, they would turn off their engines and glide through the night. Their planes were too small to even show up on Nazi radars. But the way that the Germans could hear them was like, it would make, their planes would make a soft whooshing sound, which reminded them of witch's broom. But by the time they heard that sound, it was too late. The ladies would drop their bombs, go back to base, strap on new bombs, and continue the cycle all throughout the night. From June 1942 to October 1945, these brave women flew 23,672 combat sorties and dropped over 23,000 tons of bombs on Nazi targets. They basically stopped the Nazis from sleeping throughout the night, which drained German morale. So the Germans started calling them night witches. It was supposed to be a derogatory term, but like all the cards that they were dealt with, these women took that disadvantage into their strength. And that's why. Wait for them to ask you who you know.
Green robe of the novitiate, the princess's name is added to the roll of bards. At the Logenstern, the archdruid, taking her hands in his, pronounced the bardic welcome.
Elizabeth of Windsor.
Her Royal Highness was then conducted by the recorder to her place between her sponsors, one of whom, Mrs. Coombe Tennant, dressed the hood. Later in the pavilion, the princess addressed druids, bards, and hobbits, concluding in Welsh, on with the Eisteddfod flood, and every blessing to Wales.
An archdruid salutes a princess, and Wales remembers yet another Eisteddfod.
Okay, well, I don't know much about druids, so I think that's what we'll spend the day looking up. But what I do know is the druid princess witch passed away and they snapped her wand and everything changes. The solar flares came, the frequencies, Nubaru took over, the rain started doing weird stuff, the animals wouldn't go in the rain, the frequencies in the water got all crazy. So I'm just going to say is that when they snapped her wand, it's like a veil or a hex or something was lifted. And I had to point it out again, okay, you guys, look at the Game of Thrones chair. It's a circle with a star inside of it. I wonder why she couldn't sit inside there. Could you even go inside?
Years of folklore history, may I present Baba Yaga. Today, she is most commonly depicted as an ugly, evil witch. But that wasn't always her story. Baba Yaga was once more goddess than witch, who reigned over time, life, death, and the elements. She was associated with strong winds and dark forests, connected to the earth, the heavens, and the underworld. She straddles the boundary between life and death. Associated with powerful magic and accused of cannibalism, she has immense powers over animals, the elements, and even time. Not all stories explicitly depict Baba Yaga as an ugly witch, but most Russians would. She is portrayed as a tall, gaunt old woman. Many tales reference her bony leg, which might be severe thinness, or it might be a literal skeleton leg. She has disheveled hair and a sometimes iron nose that is so long she can lie down on the floor of her hut and it could touch the ceiling. That large nose allows her to identify her visitors by scent, leading some folklorists to argue that she's actually blind. The powerful Yaga always lives somewhere remote, usually in a deep forest. Her home, while occasionally a grand mansion, is most often a hut supported by chicken legs, goat legs, ram horns, or spindles, and is surrounded by a fence made from human bones, with a lock on her gate made from the sharp teeth of a human jaw. So you can see why people think she might be a cannibal. The hut is constantly spinning and will only stop with the chant, little house, turn your back to the forest, your front to me. Baba Yaga's possessions are just as mystical and complex. No flying broom for this witch. The Baba Yaga travels on a magical flying mortar, using a pestle to urge it on, sweeping away the path of her flight with a broom. She owns enchanted mirrors that turn into lakes, combs that can transform into forests, handkerchiefs that become rivers, a flying carpet, and fire-breathing horse. The first written mention of the Baba Yaga is in the 1755 notes of a Russian grammar book penned by poet and scientist Mikhail V. Lomonosov. He referred to Yaga Baba twice, including in a list comparing Roman gods with their Slavic and Russian correspondents, although she is given no counterpart. The first narrative account of the Baba Yaga is in Vasily Levshin's 1780 collection, Russian Fairy Tales, in which she is depicted as terrifying and dangerous, with teeth like tusks and hands like bear claws. She can be altruistic, giving the protagonist of the story gifts or advice. And even in the scariest stories, when she's a child kidnapper, a warrior witch, or a cruel trickster, the protagonist always escapes. And despite her iron teeth and associations with cannibalism, no one in Baba Yaga stories is ever eaten. Many Baba Yaga stories feature a young protagonist just entering into adulthood or marriage. In one such story, a father gives his daughter to Baba Yaga as a servant. The daughter completes her assigned chores perfectly, with the help of little mice. Impressed by her work, Baba Yaga rewards the girl with beautiful clothing. When the father checks to see if his daughter is alive, he is surprised to find her very rich. He takes her home, but her stepmother, of course there's an evil stepmother, is jealous, so she sends her own daughter to Baba Yaga, but this girl chases the mice with a rolling pin and doesn't do any of the work required of her, so Baba Yaga breaks her into pieces and puts her bones in a box. Not exactly evil, not quite benevolent there, Baba Yaga. That said, many names for ancient Slavic deities have been lost over time, and this may be the case for Baba Yaga. Perhaps the moniker is a substitute for her original name that was once so sacred or feared, likely both, that it could not be said out loud and is now lost to history. Attempts to explain Baba Yaga in the 18th century actually make this association with ancient Slavic deities as well, including early indications that she was a pagan goddess. After all, she is associated with supernatural powers and magical gifts and has power over life and death. Godlike traits.
Okay, Rob, how does the word spear finger make you feel?
Not good.
Well, you're definitely not gonna like this then. Spearfinger is the Cherokee legend of a witch that lures children away from their parents so she can eat their livers.
Are you kidding me right now? In these beautiful woods, you're telling me there's a witch out there just waiting to eat me?
Children. She eats children. And I'm pretty sure no one wants to eat your liver. Anyway, Spearfinger is a witch with a long spear-like finger made of obsidian. Legend has it, she's still roaming the mountains of Great Smoky Mountains National Park, trying to lure children away from their parents.
In Cherokee folklore existed a figure known as Spearfinger, a woman with stone-like skin and an elongated razor-sharp finger on her right hand that she would use to slice open her victims. She would walk the trails and rivers surrounding the Great Smoky Mountains in Tennessee and North Carolina. It's said that you can hear Spearfinger humming her favorite song, echoing throughout the mountains and scaring away any nearby wildlife. Although nobody was safe, she preferred to target children, transforming herself into family members to deceive them. She could also take the form of a helpless elderly woman. Those kind enough to offer her assistance are left regretting their decision. Defeating Spearfinger was near impossible, as her skin was made of stone. Arrows and any other kind of sharp weapon would merely bounce off her. Her only known weakness was that her heart was located in her right palm, and so she clutches it tight, using her elongated finger as protection. Eventually, the Cherokee tribes came together and devised a plan to finally kill Spearfinger. Under advice from a medicine man, they dug a large pit, and with green sapling created a bushfire large enough to attract her attention. She came to the village disguised as an elderly woman, asking for assistance. The hunters soon realized this was a disguise and began to attack. The spears thrown bounced and ricocheted. This only angered Spearfinger as she ran towards them. However, this was expected, and in chasing them, she had fallen into the pit. Even with her trapped, the Cherokee had no idea how to kill her. They noticed the birds who were once terrified of Spearfinger flew down to offer assistance. One bird began to sing. The sound it was making translated to mean heart. The hunters took this to mean shoot her in her chest, and so they took the bird's advice. The arrows and spears once again could not penetrate Spearfinger's skin, and so they turned to the bird and cut out its tongue, enraged it would lie to them. However, the bird did not lie. The hunters were unaware that her heart was not located in her chest. Another bird flew down, but this time landed on Spearfinger's right hand. The hunters listened again and began to attack the hand that was always closed so tightly. Only now Spearfinger began.
Witchcraft delves into all kinds of dark arts, magic, and theories of doom. This ancient book is currently housed at the Library of Congress. It's called The Discovery of Witchcraft, written in 1584 by Reginald Scott. The book was so shocking when it came out that it outraged King James I because it was so heretical. And yet this book on witchcraft, which was published originally in English, became influential in the coming years when it came to practicing magic. Shakespeare researched this very book for the scenes he used with witches in Macbeth. Stage magicians have plagiarized and consulted the publication for hundreds of years. And today, its dark secrets have been transferred to the internet for the world to see. The book was groundbreaking for its time as an encyclopedia on magic and spells, and also juggling. The author consulted dozens of previous grimoires, or books on science, tales of the occult, and everything he could get his hands on to create the most impressive compendium of the day. But here's where things get interesting. Reginald Scott described witches not as evil, but as very capable women who practiced folk healing and sleight of hand. He also claimed that their miraculous feats weren't wicked at all, describing a witch not as a consort of the devil, but as a wise woman. But his book went on to be plagiarized and twisted in such a way that the original message was lost, and within just a few years, witches were regarded as evil once again, and people were using the spells in the book for all kinds of shenanigans. Were, back in the 1600s, a book called The Wonderful Discovery of Witches in the County of Lancaster is right up your alley. This forbidden book details witch trials that took place between August 18th and 19th, 1612. Today, these events are known as the Lancashire Witch Trials. Out of the 20 men and women who were accused of being witches, 11 were found guilty and hanged. One of them was sentenced to stand in the pillory, while the rest were acquitted on the charges. And for those who don't know what a pillory is, or rather was, seeing as we don't use them anymore, it was a device erected on a post with holes for a person's head and hands. It was a kind of public humiliation. The person was made to stand on a podium with their head and hands stuck in a wooden block. While they were stuck there, the townspeople threw insults at them and even physically abused them. The reason this book exists at all is because the clerk at the trials, Thomas Potts, was ordered by the judge to write a full account of the proceedings. This made them the best recorded witch trials in the 17th century. The account was even submitted to the judges, who then tinkered and corrected the manuscript before publishing it in the form of a book. The historian Stephen Pumphrey has suggested that the judges manipulated the story told by the clerk to both protect and advance their careers, reforming what was literally a witch hunt into a legitimate
Julia trial. Brown. Julia Brown was a well-known voodoo practitioner and witch in her small town in Louisiana. People knew her for her charms and her curses, as well as the creepy songs that she would sing on her porch with her guitar. In her community, people would come to her and she would perform a number of different rituals for them. That was until people started to take advantage of her, so she started to get back at them. When they came to her, she would scare them by telling them predictions like they're gonna die soon or bad things were coming for them. Then the locals were like, "Hey, what's going on with her?" Close to her death, Julia started to act strange. She would constantly sing songs about her death and how she would get revenge on the town. One song that she would sing goes as so: "When I die, I take the whole town with me. When I die, I take the whole town." Not a very cheery and upbeat song, if you ask me. In fact, no one knew what she was talking about until the day that she passed away. On September 29th, 1952, Julia passed away. On that day, the town came together for her funeral. Well, as they were lowering her casket into the ground, rain came down hard. This rain later turned into a disastrous hurricane that wiped out the entire town. So it's believed that before she left, she put a curse on the town, which is what she meant by, "When I die, I'm taking the whole town with me." Over the years, a number of people have attempted to rebuild the town, but every time they do, it ends up getting destroyed. Gerald Gardner. Gerald Gardner is often called the father of modern witchcraft, and that's due to the fact that he founded Wicca. Although technically he learned it from a group of people and then went on to just write about it, so they gave him credit for it. But anyways, basically, back in 1939, he said that one night he encountered a group of women who claimed to be witches. They stripped him of his clothes and put him in the middle of a ceremonial circle. The circle was lined with naked women, and they showed him their ways. From there, he learned briefly about Wicca and thought, "Hey, this is great, let's preserve this and make sure that everyone knows about it." In 1954, he actually created a book titled Witchcraft Today that teaches others how to embrace Wicca fully. He then went on and became obsessed with the occult. In fact, it's believed that a number of Wiccans and pagans were saved partly because of him. They could come out and be like, "Yeah, I'm a witch," without fear of being hanged or burned alive. To this day, he's one of the most relevant witches in history, but also one of the more controversial ones. He was a Scottish woman from Aldern, a village near the Scottish Highlands. She is well known in history because in 1662, she confessed to witchcraft and may have been executed. We actually don't know because there's no official record of it, so it's a mystery. Basically, during that time, if you were thought to be a witch, they would torture you until you admitted to being one, even if you weren't actually one. Well, Isabel's case sparked a lot of interest because she admitted to being a witch willingly without torture or anything. And she went into great detail on everything that she was doing. She gave four separate confessions given over a 6-week period. For example, she said she made a pact with the devil and had been engaging in intercourse with him. She also said that she was part of a coven and would cast spells on the community. She claimed she put a curse on some male authority figures who she felt victimized by. She also cursed her landlord for being a pervert and put one on the local church minister. Lastly, she also admitted that she had the ability to turn into animals and that she was interacting with fairies. Over the centuries, a number of people have analyzed Isabel and have come up with some explanations for her actions. One is that she suffered from psychosis or hallucinations, whereas others think it was a ploy to get maybe a more lenient sentence. But of course, you still have the people who believe that she was an actual witch and did everything that she admitted to doing.